Everyone. Welcome back. It's good to have you here. Welcome if you're joining us from First or Maranatha, maybe you're joining from live stream. Welcome. It's good to have you. I will be opening with a word of prayer and then I will hand it over to Pastor Rich. So let's pray together. God, we thank you that you have brought us safely here this evening. Lord, what a gift that we belong to you, that you care for us, and that you provide for us. Lord, you know that what we're going to be talking about is potentially sensitive for a lot of people across our, maybe our church, across our classes, our denomination, and even across North America. People are asking a lot of questions and a lot of wonderings. Lord, we ask that as we have our time together tonight, that you would be present with us, Lord, that we would have an eye and a heart to be faithful to you, that you'd give Pastor Rich the ability to speak clearly, and Lord, and that you would help us to thoughtfully work through these things. Lord, we ask that you would be glorified, that your church would be built up, and that your church would remain united in serving you and ministering to the people that you put in our path. Lord, we love you. We thank you that you have taken the first steps of loving us first. We ask this night would be part of our faithful response to walking with you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Come on.
Let's talk about sex, baby. Let's talk about you and me. Let's talk about all the good things and the bad things that
like that?
I know somebody I could blame, but I won't. Anyway, good to be with you this evening. And the goal is to introduce to you the Human Sexuality Report of the Christian Reformed Church. It's been around for over a year now, and it was begun in 2016. Back then, our synod asked that another report be set aside that they had earlier, suggested or implemented, but then they decided that that report was insufficient, too narrow in scope, and they appointed a new committee with a 5-year mandate to explore all sorts of sexual issues, not just homosexual marriage or same-sex marriage. So, backing up 50 years for a minute, in 1973, Synod adopted its probably first report on something of this nature, the report on homosexuality. And back then, Synod made the distinction between being born with a homosexual desire and being one who acts on that desire. The first is not sinful, Synod said, but the second is. So having or being homosexual is not sinful, but acting on it is considered sinful. So the church's job, they said, is to help support our brothers and sisters who struggle with these desires. And over the past 50 years, every time our synod has another kind of report on sexuality, it has gone back to the 73 report, said that is a good theological foundation. We trust that. The hard work was done then. It's still valid today. Scripture doesn't change. It's been reaffirmed over and over again, and it keeps coming back to that. So now let me share a few stories, just to switch gears a little bit. Stories of my own personal experiences related to sex. And don't worry, Patsy, I won't talk about you. She's always worried when I talk about us. Anyway, I'm just doing this to break the ice and to help us understand that we all have a sexual background, a story of our own, and we've got our own ways of determining what was right or wrong in those things. I think I was probably about 10 years old when I found my first Playboy magazine in the back seat of my brother's car. And I was immediately very interested and curious. And I can't say that it was good, although my God-given desire for sex was aroused at that point. Yet, looking back, I wish it hadn't been. Pornography is not a healthy entry into sexual expression. When I was about 13, I went with my parents on a work trip and helped my dad do some work at a farm in northern BC. And while we were there, one of the carpenters on the job site took an interest in us and befriended us. And he was a member of the local Christian Reformed Church and seemed very nice. The night before we left to go home, which was quite a drive, a couple of days anyway, he invited us to his home for a private barbecue. And before we left, he said to me, "Why don't you come in the truck with me?" And so I thought, well, he's a nice guy, I'll do that. And as we were driving, he began to talk strange talk, and he leaned over and grabbed my private parts and said a few more just troubling things. And it was, needless to say, very disturbing. And when I told my parents after we got home a few days after that, I think they believed me, but they didn't do anything about it. They were perplexed. Around that time, I also had a friend who had connections to some girls, and without going into details, I saw and did more than I should have. And because of that, I dealt with a lot of guilt and shame for several years. After getting married, those old pornography experiences and other real-life sins didn't leave my mind. What people often don't realize is that God calls us to be monogamous because it's good for us. It strengthens our marriage when we're monogamous, because that's what he wants for us. He wants us to grow together. But when we have other thoughts and other people's images that we're dragging in, adulterous thoughts only, it nonetheless damages our relationship. So God's grace, most of all, in a good marriage, communication with a great wife, that's where you get mentioned, helped to bring some healing. So over the years, pastorally then, I'm thankful to God for giving me some healing, and that also has allowed me to learn from my sinful mistakes in order to understand His grace more and to help His people understand grace more. Part of that understanding is why He's given us a lot of instructions about sex in the Bible. Sexual sin, lots of sexual sin is mentioned as something that we need to avoid. And I want to stop here for a moment and just say a couple things. Number one, I might not say everything the best possible way here tonight, and I apologize in advance for that if I say something that is insensitive or hurtful in some way to you. It's not my intention at all. Secondly, I want to acknowledge that some of you here in person and some of you watching online are very well struggling with sexual sins or sexual issues. You might be heterosexual, homosexual, transgender, or something else, but you are struggling in some way, and I hope that you can trust that you are welcome here, and that anyone that is here will not be condemned. We're trying to relay here tonight the findings of a study committee that may not be agreeable to you, or maybe, but we're trying to explore a lot of things around sexual expression, identity, and our struggles in this regard. Thirdly, then, my desire here is not simply to give us information. That is primarily it, but what I really want for us to understand is what God's will is for us. This is about discipleship, really. All of life of a Christian is about discipleship. How do I love God above all? And how do I love myself as God intends? And how do we all love our neighbors better in regard to dealing with sexual realities that our friends and neighbors are dealing with, and ourselves? In short, I want us to learn how to be better disciples of Jesus, who submit our whole lives to God and to His standards for everything, not just sex. Now, if you allow me a minute here, I'd like to say that as I was flying to North Carolina a couple weeks ago, I listened to a podcast, or actually a lecture on preaching. And I was gripped by one line that said something like this: as a preacher, your congregation must know that you love them more than you love being loved by them. Understand? He was saying that it's vital that your church knows that your number one desire is to tell them what God says. And even when that's hard, you're willing to do that. You're willing to step outside of your desire to be loved by them in order to tell them what's deeper, what God says, even when it's hard. If preaching is about making people like you, if that's a higher priority, then you have no integrity and no credibility. And really, then, my love for you and for God is less than it should be. The congregation, he said, must know then that the preacher loves them and is willing to tell them the hard things from God, even if it means they won't like you. Now, we tell our kids this kind of thing all the time. I mean, we did when we were growing up. Don't like me? Not my problem. I love you, and I'm telling you this because I love you. And that's God's desire for us, too, is that He loves us, and He wants to tell us what's good for us. And finally, just to be clear about our intentions here this evening, it is to summarize the HSR, and in subsequent gatherings, we will engage with it more. We'll fire back and forth. And so I invite you to ask questions later on if there's time, but I might not give you very detailed answers or satisfactory answers tonight. But I hope I can do that in subsequent meetings, and I'm hoping to bring in people who can talk about this a lot better than me as well, including Peter Rockhold, who's wonderful pastor in Red Deer, and is a man who loves the Lord deeply, and we'll talk about that later. Anyway, now, quick little break here, just before we get into the report. Stand up, please. If you're by yourself, go to somebody near you that you can talk to that's also by themselves, if you don't mind. Patsy. Okay, you don't have to do this, but I invite you to do it. Turn to the person beside you, and if you don't mind, say, who told you about the birds and the bees? Okay? How old were you? Did anybody tell you about the birds and the bees? All right, you don't have to make a sermon out of it. All right, you can be seated. So the question is, did you learn it from anybody in your family, or did you learn it from Playboy or the internet or something like that? Did you learn it from church or from your friends? I'm guessing, though, that that little exercise shows you that talking about sexuality can be tough, a little bit awkward, regardless of who we are. And that was an easy question. You can only imagine how challenging it would have to be then for people writing a report of this magnitude. This report is intended to serve the whole denomination. Now, this is about double the pages of the report because I got all kinds of other stuff included there. But it's 150 pages, plus 25 pages of appendices, lots of small print and larger print. But anyway, we have a 12-page executive summary, and I don't know if any of you have looked at that stuff. Have any of you done so? I know Chris has. Anybody else? Yeah, a handful of people. Okay, good, good. But anyway, my job here is to try to help us understand what that report entails and recognize that one of the things that the executive summary misses is a lot of the practical implications, the pastoral implications of where the rubber hits the road. And so I'm going to touch on those as well, hopefully. Now, as I said, since 1973, the CRC has held the position that homosexual orientation is not sinful, but that homosexual action or activity is. So it's not wrong to have same-sex attraction, but it is considered sinful to act on it. This is similar to saying to a heterosexual person, it is not sinful to find another man's or woman's spouse attractive, but it is sinful to make moves on that person. The point is that Synod recognized that we all have temptations that come from our brokenness due to the fall or from our sinful desires. The Holy Spirit gives us strength, we believe, to manage those temptations, helping us steer away from sin that dishonors God with our bodies. An old hymn that Charlie has taught us, one of those country hymns that Charlie likes to sing, "Where the Roses Never Fade." It's at the funeral this coming Saturday that I have to lead, so that's where I kind of got it reacquainted with it. It says, "In this world we have troubles, Satan's snares we must evade. We'll be free from all temptations where the roses never fade." But we're not there yet. We still have temptations that we have to deal with. As I mentioned, there have been more synodical reports since 1973, each affirming the 73 theology, but continuing to ask us to do better pastorally. So in 2016, a two-year study report came to Synod with proposals on same-sex marriage, but that report was rejected by Synod, which asked for something more comprehensive, and that is the HSR, which is before us now. And this is the mandate that they were given in 2016. It'll be on the screen, I believe. That Synod appoint a new study committee to articulate a foundation-laying biblical theology of human sexuality that pays particular attention to biblical conceptions of gender and sexuality. The central aim of this theological task will be to provide concise yet clear ethical guidance for what constitutes a holy and healthy Christian sexual life, and in light of this, to serve the church with pastoral, ecclesial, and missional guidance that explains how the gospel provides redemptive affirmation and hope for those experiencing sexual questioning, temptation, and sin. And that's the report coming to Synod this year. Specifically, this report was supposed to do three things. show how new modern readings of Scripture do or don't fit with a Reformed hermeneutic, Reformed interpretation of reading of Scripture. Dialogue with and critique as necessary arguments about a new movement of the Holy Spirit, much like we read in Acts 15, where Peter says it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us. And three, give advice to future synods about whether synod should change the status of church order Article 69 about marriage being between a man and a woman, and whether this report and our position as a denomination is considered confessional. Got it all? Lots of words, but it's important. The original committee appointed by Synod was required to hold the 1973 position, with the exception of one person who was called to be kind of the devil's advocate on the committee, reminding them of alternative positions and views of Scripture that may have been overlooked. Just for information, the committee was composed of seven white people, one Latino, one black, one Korean. Three of them were women and seven were men. Three were single, one was attracted to same-sex partners, seven married, five pastors with experience from church planting to established churches to campus pastors among the poor, urban, and rural, five professors specializing in psychology, social work, moral philosophy, and theology. So a pretty broad spectrum of people with a lot of different skills. The committee met extensively with various people. Lots of stories were shared back and forth with the committee. They reviewed synodical feedback from the 2019 midterm report, and they continued to build toward this final paper. Now, the report itself, in the preamble, covers good sex, or our current context and the church's response, or lack thereof. It states, the church has been mostly silent about sex, and when it does speak, it is often very pastorally unhelpful. We often minimize the reality of pornography, which is a huge issue in our world, and equally so in the church, but we tend to brush it under the carpet. The church hasn't been great at dealing with the reality of sexual abuses like incest and child abuse. We've been very poor at dealing with the reality of premarital sex and adultery. We've been poor at dealing with the increasing number of people who come out of the closet in more recent years, being attracted to only one or the same sex, being transgender or gender nonconforming. When we as a church do speak, we all too often are very dogmatic and not very pastoral, which can be hurtful and not helpful. So the report's critical of us and our background. The report, however, affirms that sex is good. God gave it to us as a gift to be used exclusively in monogamous, God-honoring relationships. It's created to strengthen our bonds, to create trust, to deepen love, and even to improve our mental and physical health at some point. God has given us the gift of physical intimacy to help each of us become all that He intends. So sex is good. But whether we are heterosexual or not, we live in a culture that has given us repeated false messages about sex. So every single Christian today needs help and guidance in trying to understand how to use our bodies in a way that honors God as faithful disciples of Jesus. In addition, we haven't always done a good job of modeling or teaching our young how to honor their bodies and the gift of sex. So what I especially think is important to note in the report is that it confesses that we have failed so often to give a complete view of sex that honors singleness as a faithful model of discipleship. We've made so much of marriage in the church, but we have failed to honor singleness. All of this to say that everyone's sexuality needs to be addressed in this report, and everyone's sexuality, single or married, needs redemption. Now, the theological section of the report begins with Matthew 19, and maybe in Matthew 19 you're familiar, Jesus talks about divorce. He's asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every reason? And Jesus goes back to Genesis 1. He doesn't begin with humanity in its fallen state. Instead, he starts with God's good plan. God made them male and female, he says. He reminds us of Genesis 1, where Adam and Eve were naked and felt no shame, that two become one. And that's the starting point, Jesus is saying, in God's good plan for sex. The HSR takes this as the normative starting point. This is God's good intention for human beings in regard to our sexual expression. We see the effects of sin very quickly in the Bible. Genesis 3 shows corruption. After they sin, there's shame when they are naked. There's a lot of shame associated with sin, and perhaps even more so with sexual sin. I shared how that was true for me. The Bible goes on, in the Old Testament especially, to give laws that encourage fruitfulness in marriage. There's an abundance of Old Testament stories, however, that also share sexual immorality. There's a glut of sexual immorality in the Bible, and we can take that as good news because God isn't afraid to share the brokenness of his people. We did that during Advent. We looked at Tamar, Rahab, and Bathsheba in particular. Then the wisdom literature, the Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Songs, shows both good and bad examples of sex or illustrations or talk of it. Pastor Mary Lee Bauma is a CRC minister in BC. She's a member of the committee that wrote this report, and she's a celibate lesbian. She spoke at West End CRC a couple of months ago and said, "The New Testament brings a new focus, a fresh focus, less on the family and the value of marriage for everyone, more on the value of celibate singleness. The New Testament, in that regard, highlights self-control, which everybody needs, married or single. We all need self-control. That is the fruit of the Spirit. The reason for such change, the reason we need that self-control is because of who we are in Christ. We are new creatures in Christ. We don't find our identity in family, in sex or marriage or anything like that. We don't find it in social status. Remember Paul's words, in Christ there is neither male nor female, slave nor free, Jew nor Greek. We find our identity in Christ, he says. So summarizing then, as those who identify ourselves in Christ, we recognize, number one, for Jesus, sex is for heterosexual marriage only because that's what God intended from creation. Plus, Jesus teaches that marriage is not an eternal state. I mean, we always talk about, oh, when I get to heaven, I'm going to see my spouse. Well, you might. I mean, they hopefully are there, but I don't know that you'll recognize them and care about them in the way that you do here on earth. Marriage is one of the most beautiful things we have in this world, but Jesus says there's something better in heaven, a relationship with him. He's our greatest love. So we need to keep that in mind. It's a temporary state. Paul adds then that the need for all Christians, homosexual, heterosexual, or anyone else, is to be controlled by the Spirit, as Mary Lou Bauma pointed out. In an amazing chapter in Romans 8, you know, we all love that chapter, and for various reasons, there's no condemnation in Christ, and there's nothing that can separate us from the love of Christ. But in the middle, those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the Spirit desires spiritual things. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. That's one thing Paul says. And then he mentions purity as a mark of the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians 6. He says that what we do with our bodies matters a lot because our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and it's destined for resurrection and greater unity with Christ. And then in 1 Corinthians 7, unmarried Paul says, "I wish that all of you were as I am, but each of you has your own gift from God. And some people say that that means singleness and celibacy, but that gift, says the HR, refers to HSR, the Human Sexuality Report, says that gift refers to self-control, which applies to all Christians, not merely to singles. So the theology section moves us from valuing marriage for everyone to valuing life as citizens of God's kingdom and living for God above all else, whether we're single or married. But singleness and celibacy are exalted in the New Testament because it's something that God has in mind for all of us eternally. We will be single, or at least married to Him in that sense. And we'll come back to that. Then there's a section briefly on special and general revelation. I think most of us know what that is, but special revelation is the Bible, and we can trust it completely, but we do have to read it properly and interpret it correctly. We need to be careful, the study committee says, when looking at general revelation, creation, for messages from God. It reminds us that they are there, messages from God in creation, which includes science and all that, but we need the right approach. You've probably heard that John Calvin talks about scriptures as being the spectacles through which we look at the world. So the spectacles by which we can properly identify God's revelation in creation. And the report says, creation is the data of science, but often our understanding of the data is colored by cultural understanding. For example, people used to think that science taught us that the world was flat. So what we take away from our view of nature is most often our cultural response to scientific data. And therefore, we cannot say that general revelation speaks with 100% clarity like Scripture does. And I think that little section of the report was given just because there's some report coming out of one of the other classes, which tries to say that both Scripture and creation are equal in authority and equal in revealing God's will to us. So that would mean that we can say science speaks as authoritatively to matters of human sexuality as the Bible does. And the report's saying, no, it doesn't. Now, we get to the heart of the report, which contains three sections on pornography, gender identity, and homosexuality. And each section has three subsections of cultural context, scripture, and pastoral care. And I'm going to invite Chris Van Boom up here for a minute. He spoke at the council meeting, and he's been on one of the committees that, or subcommittee of council that's been looking a little bit at the Human Sexuality Report. And he shared something at the council meeting. Come on up, Chris, just to say how he has grown in his understanding of this. And just so as a little break in here, we'll just listen to Chris. He's got a lot nicer voice than me.
Well, I'm not as prepared as Pastor Rich is, but at the council meeting, I basically just shared my own experience with this and gave a little bit of a background as to why I'm expressing an interest in this. It goes back, my son had his 13th birthday today, so I guess it goes back about 14 years. My wife and I were getting into the adoption system, and that requires something that they call a home study. And if you haven't been a part of that, it's an invasion into every deep, dark sector of your past and history and your every thought. And when the person who was doing the home study heard that we were from a Christian Reformed background, there was a little bit of a judgment passed on us. And, I just gotta take this off. It had to do with our openness if we adopted a child who had gay tendencies or gender identity issues. And so we gave the generic response, I think, that any Christian Reformed person would give. What the 1973 report is always summed up as, and we always hear it, is love the sinner, hate the sin. And so that was kind of our answer. It was pretty generic. She took that. She really raked us over the coals about it, but we left her rest assured that whatever child we adopted, we would love them regardless of anything. And yeah, it became a non-issue in the end. And so it's kind of where I left it for quite a few years. And then about 3 years ago, the conversation started to ramp up again. I was in council, started hearing more things, and still in the back of my mind, like, where am I at with this? Walking around saying love the sinner, hate the sin is not enough. And the feeling that I was a little bit put in my place, like I was judged, I was a Christian Reformed person, and there was an immediate like, oh, I'm gonna have a problem with having a gay kid. Sorry to be so blunt, but that's just, you know, these are the way people speak about these things. And so I thought, well, maybe I need to be more educated and understand the world around me. And so at that time, if you'll recall, there were several meetings happening at, I believe it was the West End Church, about the Human Sexuality Report, and things were getting a little heated. There was a lot of talk going around, like this was a pretty contentious issue. And so it was a few weeks or maybe months after those meetings at the West End, they were going to have another one at Covenant CRC, and I thought, I'm gonna go to that one on behalf of council, take some notes, see what it's all about. And it was there that I started to hear things that our churches are open to, that I'd been turning a blind eye to, that I was like, wow, this is way more open to things than I thought we were. And that's, I don't say that in a bad way. I say that what I've learned is a great way. The 1973 report was way too generic, and there's a lot of aspects, I guess, to the whole human sexuality. And in studying it, I learned so many things. There's a huge difference between sexual orientation and sexual desire, and all of the different dynamics that go along with that. And so, I guess in my studying, I've learned that my ignorance may be the reason why our church is painted with a little bit of a stigmatism, that we are not accepting of all people. And I am learning that we should change. I should change. I shouldn't speak for all of us. It's Pastor Rich's job. I needed to change my way of thinking. I need to change my narrative so that when I walk through life, because it's not about what we say here so much as what we say when we are out there. And when people know that you are a Christian and then they hear you say things that are not loving of every aspect of everybody, that's what gives the church a bad name. And so that's my primary reason for studying this so deeply, and going to classes yesterday was actually very heartwarming for me to hear that churches are very open. I didn't know what to expect from all the other churches in our classes, but I was, regardless of all the semantics that were argued over the human sexuality report, the one thing that rang true was that every church wants to welcome everybody. And I want that to be true for Trinity as well. And it's not to say that it isn't true for Trinity, but I think we need to work on making that very evident.
Thanks, Chris.
So yeah, what I appreciate is that Chris is saying, hey, I have to learn more. I gotta keep learning in this regard. There's a lot of stuff I don't know, and I've learned a lot now, and I want to keep learning. So that's what I hope you will come away with from tonight's session as well. So anyway, as I was saying, the report has three sections: pornography, gender identity, and homosexuality, each with cultural context, scripture, and pastoral care, and that's what we're going to look at now. In case you're wondering how long I'm going to go, well, it's about three times the length of a usual sermon. This is a month's worth of sermons in one Sunday. So, pornography is very widespread in our culture, among men, and increasingly among women, and even children now. Teachers will tell you that kids as early as kindergarten are now talking about sexual things that you'd never expect to hear from a five-year-old a generation ago. But they are apparently learning it at home, or even viewing it sometimes, because mom and dad are viewing that kind of stuff at home, and they're picking it up. And sometimes it's because of sexual abuse, very sadly. Not surprisingly, porn, as you know, is everywhere. It has infiltrated every area of society in ways that most of us don't even know and can't imagine, and beyond the ways I even understand in many things. But it certainly is in the church. We shouldn't fool ourselves. Statistics tell us that porn use is pretty much the same among Christians as it is in broader society. Gone are the days when you had to sneak around and find a magazine like I did when I was a boy. Now it's all just a click away on your computer and can be viewed in the privacy of your own home or bedroom and on your telephone. And pastors are not immune from what we hear. A 2016 Barna study said most pastors were either former or current users of porn, somewhere around 80%, if I heard that correctly. Now, the funniest part of that, it's not funny, but this part is, sad comment that Mary Lee Bauma made is that most Christians feel no guilt and don't try to stop, but the study said pastors at least feel a little bit of guilt. And well, we should. The report notes that contemporary porn is increasingly violent. Its victims are many, women, children first and foremost. But along with that, marriages are destroyed by porn. Brains crave stimulation like addicts for another hit. Young men apparently are growing increasingly impotent in relationships, real relationships, because they're not as stimulating as porn. And women are being conditioned to accept men's domination, while men are being trained to be violent with women. Sex has been commodified to sell. On top of this, it leads to oppressing the poor. Maybe you don't think of this, but you know, when we were in Thailand, when Rachel was sick, and in Bangkok in particular, you know, we loved the Thai people. They're so kind and peaceful and loving and good-hearted. But then in the underbelly of the city is a dirty secret. In the resort towns is a dirty secret. Young girls are sold by their poor parents to sex traffickers in order to put food on the table for the rest of the family. That's sad and wrong. In short, that's what porn does. Porn destroys people's lives due to abuses. It destroys marriages. It destroys other relationships through deceit and lying that's used to cover it up. Those are just a few of the negative effects, but they are astronomical. From the Bible, then, we know that such immorality is sinful, and also, more importantly, that there is redemption. There's always redemption. Jesus desires restoration for men and for women, as well as for children and others who are harmed by pornography. He longs for us to know how to honor each other and honor one another's bodies. Porn hurts, porn kills, it exalts darkness and must be brought into the light. So pastorally, churches can't allow it to be a private matter anymore. We must acknowledge it, must help one another deal with it. We need to teach our youth healthy sex as described by God in the Bible. We need to be the ones who tell our kids about the birds and the bees, if you weren't able to answer that question earlier. We need to confess this sin of pornography and lament it in our public worship. We need to pray for those who struggle with it. We need to pray for the offenders, for the victims, and for the families. We need to support those looking for ways out of this addiction and who feel betrayed or hurt by loved ones using porn. As with all sin, we need to give the opportunity for repentance and forgiveness, as well as help in leaving the sin behind. That's pornography. Now, gender identity. Culture. The term gender identity is probably relatively new to many of us. Years ago, gender and sex were used interchangeably. But today, sex is your physical identity. God made them male and female, is understood as our biological sex. And gender is used to describe how a person feels or identifies and the roles they play. We live in a culture of expressive individualism that has grown out of good seed, the desire for all people to have dignity and equal human rights. Those are biblical values that came in to the church through the Reformation, came into society through the Reformation times. But it has gone on now to become freedom to be and do as I please, maybe provided as long as I don't hurt anybody else. Human autonomy today is one of the highest goods in our culture. We celebrate human freedom without any restrictions. We are openly using our bodies today however we wish, putting whatever we wish into our bodies or onto our bodies, taking out of our bodies whatever we wish as well. And that's an allusion to abortion, I think. It's like our body is a blank canvas, and we paint it whatever we want it to be. The given canvas, sex, doesn't matter. One writer quoted in the report says, "If the body cannot be defined, then it places no constraints on our gender identity. The goal is complete freedom to declare oneself a man or a woman or both or neither. The sovereign self will not tolerate having its opinions limited by anything it did not choose, not even its own body." That's from the report. Again, page 61 of the full HSR, it gives a whole list of terms related to gender, and a few of them you may have heard of before, many you may not have heard. Cisgender, orders of or disorders of sexual development, which is DSDs or intersex. There's gender dysphoria, there's gender nonconforming, there's transgender, there's many more. Our classes has a 2 or 3 page document that also lists a whole bunch of vocabulary that says we ought to become familiar with, and I can make that available to you. But the report states that the terms cannot do justice to the complexities, the pain and the difficulties of persons who experience those conditions. This is where it gets a little more pastoral again. These are mostly problems related to people's brain sex not being their same as their body or their biological sex. However, the report says there isn't good science available in this regard yet. Biblically, then, the report says the distinction between sex and gender is foreign to the Bible. And so it encourages us to stick to the Bible's story of creation, fall, redemption, and consummation to fully appreciate how God wants his people to live even while experiencing the effects of fall in our sexuality. It says, tragically, some people experience a disconnect between their gender identity and their sex, and we need to walk with them through the struggle. There's a lot of pain and a lot of confusion in many people today in this regard, and it's good to know what the Bible says. We need to be clear on that, but it's also clear that we cannot be hammering such hurting people on the head with Bible verses. Instead, it's important to know that gender is not a word we find in the Bible, but in the Bible there is considerable latitude in what being male and female looks like. It's not as simple as boys wear blue and girls wear pink, or other stereotypes like that. The Bible does say there are only two sexes, male and female, and that our bodies are good, created good. So our body does matter. It doesn't matter less than the soul. They are both valuable. And because the body is also eternal, it's important that we try to use it for the glory of God now in the way that God understands. We're not dualists in this regard, who think the soul is the important part of a person and the body is, well, just do with it what you want, it's dispensable because it's temporal. The body's eternal. It's good to remember that Jesus preached, as I alluded to earlier, not family, but church family. Women would be blessed for discipleship, Jesus said, not for childbearing, as was more common in the Old Testament. Men could be single for the kingdom, Jesus said. Paul said that as well. Jesus said, hate your father and mother. Not that he meant that literally, but biologically. That's not the important relationship he's talking about. He traveled with men and with women. He called them sisters and brothers are those who do the will of God. Now, this isn't our reality in the CRC, so we need to expand our views. Intimacy is to be found in the church. Not necessarily, of course, sexual intimacy. Church culture built around marriage and family denies singles deep Christian community that they must have, that they need, and is a failure in the church if we don't do that. As I mentioned earlier, next week or next time, I hope to have Pastor Peter Rockhold here, who's from Red Deer. He'll talk more about his perspective, and it's far beyond what the HSR suggests as some alternatives, because he's a celibate man, attracted to same-sex people, but he's got such good theology and such a great heart and a desire to live and honor the Lord. Now, in addition to these views of what's lacking in the church, we don't want to make a double standard. And we need to repent of all the times we've done that. We often, the report points out, have standards for homosexual people, but we don't have the same standards for heterosexual sin. And that's hypocrisy. We need to acknowledge that. Jesus said, I've come for the sick and not the healthy. And that means all of us. Everybody's got some brokenness in their lives. We need to repent of wrong thinking and wrong attitudes. We've failed our LGBTQ plus two family and also one another in various different ways. So I think the report does a good job in calling us to take a humble attitude that creates hope and an openness to talk about our sexual brokenness as heterosexuals, as well as those with gender identity issues. So the pastoral care for this part says should be modeled after that of Jesus. Jesus, it says, is careful, loving, and helping. We should be careful not to say there is a biblically prescribed way to live as male or female, that is, boys only do this and girls only do that. We ought not to lay unnecessary gender expectations on our children that can contribute to an unhealthy view of themselves. That includes shame and confusion. We must be willing to be on a journey with one another, a long journey to walk alongside people as they struggle. This dysphoria, we got to understand, is not really a choice. Said that before, maybe, but who chooses that kind of stuff, right? Nobody wants this. It's not an easy life. So to want to change your body comes because there's something going on inside, something deep, something painful. And so as a church, we need to be sensitive as Jesus. We need to be open and flexible and looking for ways to walk with each other before judging. Right, you may be seated. Or you can go home, but please be seated. Does this remind you of camping, Jess? When the kids were young, we went to this campground in Northern Ontario with them, and they had a very conservative Reformed Church preacher there, and from an old kind of denomination. And he preached for 30 minutes, and then he let us stand up and sing a song, and then he preached for 45 more minutes. So, we're not going to do that tonight. We're getting close to the end. But pornography, gender identity, and homosexuality are the things that this report addresses, and we'll look at the homosexuality part. Now, again, the cultural context, scripture, and pastoral care. Our culture today, in the church and outside of it, uses what is called revisionist theology by the HSR. Giving new interpretations to old texts that we thought were clear, but which are considered to be offensive in order to explain the offense away. We hear, for example, that Jesus didn't condemn homosexuality or talk about it, so it must be okay. Jesus never talked about it. In Romans, Paul is only talking about violent homosexual acts, exploitative ones, not about normal homosexual acts. Paul didn't know about same-sex orientation, so he wasn't talking about that, they say. They say Acts 15 models accepting Gentiles and should be our model of accepting and welcoming, practicing LGBT+2 people into the church. The church is to change on this score as it did for slavery and women. The report says that the Bible seems clear that every passage about homosexuality speaks of it negatively in contrast to what the revisionists say. It says it is clear, consistent, and compelling. Paul says that all homosexual activity is wrong. He doesn't talk about the degree of sin as though he is referring to homosexual sex with minors or something like that, as some revisionists contend. He speaks of the wrong object of the person. Men exchange passion for women with passions for men. He doesn't say anything about what kind of men or anything like that, and likewise, women did the same. The report states that even pro-LGBTQ scholars who know the Bible and understand it well say that these new attempts at redefining what the Bible says are strained and unhistorical. After reviewing the various arguments proposed by revisionists, scholar William Loder, who is one of those revisionists, observes, "For those of us who understand, whose understanding of Scripture does not entail such beliefs," and he's talking about beliefs that the biblical writers were correct in what they wrote, "we can only stand and wonder at the extraordinary maneuvers which have been undertaken to reread Paul as not condemning homosexual relations at all. It would be strange for the prohibition against homosexual practice to be set aside when the rest of the sexual ethic is not, especially considering how the rejection of same-sex behavior is rooted in the creation order," says the report. So, that kind of a talk, so I hope you understood that. This Loder guy is a revisionist who personally claims all these different views of the Bible so that he can say same-sex marriage is fine or homosexual activity is fine. But then he says, the Bible clearly says it's not, if you understand it the way we've been trained to understand it, believe it as the Word of God. But he says, I don't believe that. So anyway, one person I heard recently said that he went on to explore the teaching of Dr. Loder in more detail. And true, he said, Loder did agree that the Bible does say what traditionalists, us, confess about passages like Romans 1. Homosexual action in all of its forms is wrong, according to Paul. However, basically, Loder says he doesn't believe in the authority of Scripture like we do, so he says modern Christians can hold whatever view they want, but he said to say that homosexual action is sinful, in a word, is cruel. So that kind of is the gist of people who don't want to believe what the Bible says, who think the Bible has to be reinterpreted or something like that. They're saying, this is cruel. So we have to decide, is it or isn't it? So pastorally, the report says, given the biblical data, how do we address those struggling with homosexual desires and longings? The report reminds us that singleness, again, is exalted in the Bible, even though it's not easy. Again, the church needs to validate singleness and honor it. And likewise, we must stop elevating certain sexual sins above others. If premarital sex and cohabitation are on the rise in the church, we need to address that too. Churches need to recognize our double standards. We must stand on Scripture for guidance because there is more and more coming at us, friends. the report picks up on things like polyamory on the rise among Christians as well, and that's the practice of having more than one spouse. So I love my wife Patsy, but I also want another spouse. So that's okay. The three of us agree. We're going to have a polyamorous relationship. That's happening. Should the church do that? These are the things that are coming down the pike. And likewise, we need to look back. How do we deal with divorce and remarriage? We need to recognize our need to live by the Word of God. And what does that mean? How does that look for everybody, not just for people who are homosexual or otherwise? Practical advice for homosexuals, according to the report, is we need as church to foster community with other believers. Maybe a church could get in on some kind of housing project, it says, where, you know, we buy a house where people can live together and married or single, homosexual or heterosexual, enjoy Christian fellowship and deep intimacy, not sexual intimacy, but intimacy, living with one another as followers of Jesus Christ, receiving a partner of the opposite sex, possibly, with the full knowledge of the other. There's different ways that we can help one another, people who are gay. How do we create a climate of sexual holiness in the whole church, the report says? How do we address it so that all people are included, not just singled out people? How do we address things like singleness? How do we address things like premarital sex, polyamory, and divorce? How do we give pastoral guidance in this climate that we live in to young and old? So those are the kinds of things that Synod has struggled with, that Synod's asking this HSR committee to talk about. So those three things again, pornography, gender identity, and homosexuality, make up the heart of this report. And there's a lot more that could be talked about and is alluded to in the report, but those are the big three. And then the last thing that Synod wanted this committee to consider was, should this report be given confessional status? In other words, do the teachings of the confessions contradict anything in this report? Even if it has confessional status, does that mean that we expect people to obey it perfectly? The teachings of these things, the committee suggests, everything that they're teaching here, or we don't know exactly what they're suggesting, but people are saying, they're suggesting that everything in this report already has confessional status because it has biblical status. Heidelberg Catechism 108 is about living decent and chaste lives in and out of marriage. So that's one of the confessional allusions, if you will, to this report. But it's asking us, what does it mean to have confessional status? And we're trying to answer that question. We had a discussion about that at classes yesterday as well. But in any event, this is what the committee says. As a committee, we conclude, therefore, that the church's teaching on premarital sex, extramarital sex, adultery, polyamory, pornography, and homosexual sex already has confessional status. As such, there is no need for a new declaration. So that's where probably the biggest issue is with this report. People are saying, well, it's not a confessional matter. It's not like if you don't believe everything in this report, then you can't be a member of the CRC, or you can't be an office bearer, or you can't be a pastor. That's what confessional status means in some people's minds. And so we have to figure that out as well in our denomination. What do we mean by this? Or what is the committee trying to say they mean by this? And that's not really clear yet. So finally, this report ends by saying there is no need for a new declaration. And then it says, in coming to this conclusion, we observe that we stand, and this is important, with the majority church worldwide, including the Roman Catholic Church, all branches of Orthodoxy, the non-Western global church, and a majority of active Protestants in North America and Europe. Indeed, the global church finds the Western church's challenges to biblical teaching on human sexuality incomprehensive and offensive. To refuse to uphold Christian teaching on sexual morality would signal that the Christian Reformed Church in North America is deviating not only from Scripture, but from the shared confessions of the historic and worldwide church. It's pretty tough stuff in some ways. But again, I want to reiterate as I wrap up now what I said about our desire to discuss this subject as being a matter of discipleship for all of us, gay or straight, gray-haired or light-haired, everyone. All of us have struggles with sin. Sexual stuff isn't worse than other things we tend to downplay. We're all called to living holy lives which honor God and God's desires for us and in us. Christ died to make possible for us a life that we can enjoy, which the Holy Spirit helps us and calls us to live and strive for. And the goal of the report then is to help us in this regard. Whether it attains that perfectly is up for debate and will be debated at Synod. And there's a lot of hard discussions that will be had. We had them at classes yesterday. It was a powerful day in many ways. It was difficult, but good to hear from each other and to realize that we have to find a way to stick to God's word and trust God as we move forward, no matter how we figure out some of these issues. But anyway, the report ends with this, a quote from Jude. By the power of the Holy Spirit working in us, may the great shepherd of the sheep lead us together into the joyful freedom of obedience. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Now, it's 7:35. It's earlier than I thought it would be, so that's good. I'll entertain questions, and I will possibly give answers. If I don't feel I can give an answer, I'll just say next time. But feel free to step up to the mics over here if you have a question, and we will hear them. Before you start, you got to turn on that mic. Just push the button on top and wait till it turns green, and you'll be good to go.
Really have a question. Just more thoughts.
Okay.
And it's not even thoughts, but more concerns, worries. We live in a country now where a lot of our expressions are being limited, right? About sexual orientation. We can't really even go technically to a pastor with, you know, concerns about that anymore. And I'm just wondering, as a church, how are we going to be leaders in leading our children and expressing perhaps synods, you know, our stance on this?
Yeah, that's a great question, Dawn. How do we, I think you all heard it, but yeah.
And some of my thoughts, just, you know, I'm not a TV person. I listen to radio a lot more. But it's just, the church is so under attack in all forms, not only sexuality. Last week, Sunday, I happened to be listening to radio, and they were talking about how pastors should use profanity so that we all feel comfortable. Mm. You know, this is what's being taught. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, I feel like we gotta get down to the ground level and start even addressing what's being spoken by radio. You know, like, we don't need to take this anymore. Like, I don't want to hear a two-year-old, you know, using the F word. Mm-hmm. But that's what's being taught, right? Like, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, that everything is acceptable.
That is certainly a big topic, Dawn. Thank you for bringing it up. It's, you know, how do we live as Christians in our culture? And what are the things that we're going to be facing? We are increasingly going to be called to live God-fearing lives in a culture that is less and less friendly, you know, toward the gospel. And that's one of the things I think that I came away very heartened by at the classes meeting yesterday, just the number of people standing up and saying, this is a matter of the gospel. We need to take our stand and let the chips fall. And yeah, not everybody will agree with that maybe, but that's certainly a large mindset of a lot of people still as Christians. Anybody else? Question or a thought? Come on, Don, I know you're dying to ask a question. Just kidding. Anybody's welcome to come up. Okay, well, if there isn't any, that's okay. I've asked Pastor Hillary to lead us in prayer.
Will you join me in prayer? O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And Lord, we love and we trust that you promise us that your word will stand forever. And it is firm. And God, we thank you that we can trust you and trust in your word. God, we thank you for the healthy dialogue that's been happening since the report came out. A lot of people just wanting to come together with each other, with their local churches and dialoguing. We thank you for the dialogue they could have yesterday with classes, for the dialogue that's starting now in our church tonight. And as we move forward in this, God, we just pray for more, just being able to dialogue in grace and in learning with humble spirits. God, we thank you for the compassion that abounds, that we keep hearing about, where people want to understand and to learn and to want to love and to welcome the LGBTQ plus community into churches. God, we thank you for this local church at Trinity, that we can look around at each other and say, hey, this is a loving church, and we can see the intentions of each other. So God, I thank you. Thank you for that. Lord, we confess that we have failed and that we have made mistakes, and we confess that we have caused pain, and we confess that we have given double standards. And so God, just even though we may not personally have done so or done that intentionally, either our church or the church as a whole have done so. So God, we just take a moment and say we're sorry. And God, will you not hold that against us as we move forward as a church, but hear our hearts, Lord, that we want to move forward in a way that is good and according to your plan. And for that, God, we need you. So Lord, we petition you. We ask for your help. Ask for your help and your guidance for how to honor you, how to honor our bodies, how to honor the gift of sex. Lord, we need your help. Will you give us humility, the humility to learn? Give us the humility to love. Will you help us, Lord, give pastoral care, the elders and the pastors and the deacons, but also the congregation members. God, all of us here to offer care. So everyone who walks through those doors will know they are loved and they will feel safe. And Lord, we ask for help at our classes meeting coming up in March and for synod coming up with a denomination. God, we ask for unity, that everyone will come together from all the classes, Lord, and it will be good deliberation. And ultimately, Lord, we ask that your word will stand firm as you have promised. Lord, will you help your church to be a great light in the middle of this sex-saturated world? Will you help us to be bold with the gospel? God, we pray for a sexual revolution, that we will see that. And Lord, will you help us as we are often looked down upon or even persecuted because of some of the things that we say. So Lord, will you just help us to just keep to trust in your word. And Lord, we can ask all these things because we know that you love us and that you hear us. And God, we put all of our hope in you, for great is your faithfulness to us, God. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor Hillary. I invite you to stand and give the parting blessing, and then we'll sing Praise God from whom all blessings flow. A cappella. People of God, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with us and help us to be a blessing. And all God's people say, Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. We should have said, feel free to send a question or ask me a private question afterwards. Anyway, go in peace. Have a blessed week. Thanks for coming out.